In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. My Lord and my God, I firmly believe that you are here, that you see me, that you hear me. I adore you with profound reverence. I ask your pardon for my sins and the grace to spend this time of prayer fruitfully. My Immaculate Mother, Saint Joseph, my Father and Lord, my guardian angel, intercede for me. Today, the feast day of Saint Bartholomew, also called or referred to probably as Nathanael. We're not really sure whether those two people are one and the same, but there's a very strong probability, there's very strong tradition even, that they were one and the same person. We can do our prayer following an outline, the outline rather, of a discourse that Pope Benedict XVI, now a venerable, really old man, for whom we have to pray because he's a very frail health now, but who in his prime and for many decades was a powerhouse of intellectual activity in the Vatican. But now you know very well, because history has taught it, that many of the encyclicals, the documents during the long papacy of St. John Paul II, were co-authored or were pieces in which then Cardinal Ratzinger, who was the head of the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith, contributed very much. He was an intellectual. And in the early years of this millennium, he did a series of discourses on the apostles. And on October 2006, he dedicated the Wednesday audience to talking about the saint whose feast we're celebrating today. And I'd like to follow that outline because, as I said, he's a master of erudition. His name is evidently patronymic, Bartholomew Bar. In Hebrew means son of. Most probably the Aramaic Bartolmai, the son of Tolmai, or Bartalmai, the son of Talmai. According to Pope Benedict, we do not have any important information about Bartholomew. In fact, his name appears always and only within the list of the 12, as Bartholomew. However, he is identified with Nathanael, a name that means God-given. And this Nathanael was a native of Cana, as we read in John, the Gospel of St. John. Therefore, it's possible that he was witness of some great sign wrought by Jesus in that place. Remember the transformation of the wine, or rather of the water to wine in the wedding feast. Now, the identification of the two personages, according to Pope Benedict, is probably due to the fact that Nathanael, in the scene of the vocation narrated by John's Gospel, is placed next to Philip, that is, in the place that Bartholomew has in the list of the apostles, referred to by the other Gospels. When the list of the apostles are made in the Gospel, Bartholomew always appears beside Philip. And so therefore, the Nathanael that is also referred in the narrative as well, the person who Philip called, must be this Bartholomew. Now, as we know in that passage, Bartholomew posed a weighty prejudice against Jesus. And we read, Philip found Nathanael and told him, "We have found the one about whom Moses wrote in the law, and also the prophets, Jesus, son of Joseph, from Nazareth." a little bit of context. The people during the time of our Lord already were waiting for the Messiah, but there was a lot of expectation at just about that time. And there's the reason why John the Baptist, his cousin, preaching in the Jordan, attracted so much following. You know, the place where he was preaching by the Jordan in the Judean wilderness, well, you really won't get an idea about that unless you go there. It's in the middle of nowhere, arid landscape, not the desert of sand dunes, but the desert of limestone formations, bare hills, not tall ones, very low-hanging hills, but, you know, kilometers of it. Imagine a landscape of rocks, limestone rocks. Well, it was like that there. And then winding, not winding, but not even snaking, because the Jordan is pretty straight. There is a Jordan River, very shallow, very narrow, very little water flowing into the Dead Sea, just a couple of kilometers from the site. And it's amazing how, in spite of being precisely in that wilderness, of course there's a little vegetation, Jericho is close by, there's an oasis every now and then. Remember, it's close to the Jordan River. So there will be aquifers, and where the aquifers is, imagine a foam sandwiched by impervious rocks. Aquitards, they're called in geology. You have an aquifer, water, ferre is to carry, so carriers of water sandwiched by layers of rock. And of course, wherever it goes up or you puncture it, you have a well. And that's the phenomenon of the oasis in an otherwise arid geography. So he was there living for years. And the people from Jerusalem and then from Jericho and the neighboring Judean hills would go down to listen to him, despite the fact it was like a wild man, all because they were waiting for the prophet. And St. John the Baptist had been born under very mysterious circumstances. Remember that Elizabeth bore him in her old age, and even Zachary was also old at that time. So people knew there was something special about this person. But even then, it would take a lot of drive, of expectation, precisely messianic expectation, to drive a person to negotiate those kilometers to go to the Judean wilderness and to listen to St. John, which they did. And so therefore, when Philip heard the Messiah, I mean, heard Jesus, he put two and two together. This is the Messiah. And he went to tell his friend Nathanael, I have found the Messiah, the Jesus of Nazareth. And Nathanael said to him, can anything good come from Nazareth? And Philip said to him, come and see. Gives us an idea of just how insignificant Nazareth was at that time. In the narratives, they would refer to it as a city. It was more like a hovel with 50 homes of migrants, the poorest of the poor from Bethlehem, who had settled there, in search of greener pastures. And really, Galilee is green compared to Bethlehem, compared to Judea. But it was poor, insignificant, out of the way even, not even along the main road. Even now, when you go to Nazareth, you will notice that the north-south road, the one that leads from Galilee in the north to Judea in the south, goes through, through two mountains. But then Galilee, or rather Nazareth, is not there. You have to go up and beyond, and that's where you see Nazareth is now. Now it's an important city. It's the most important city in Galilee. But at that time, it was nothing. And so therefore, this comment of Nathanael was reasonable. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? And Philip's friend said, come and see. And so they went to see Jesus. And as they approached, Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, here is a true child of Israel, in whom there is no duplicity, there is no guile. Our Lord can read into the hearts of men. And despite that prejudice on the part of Nathanael, Jesus appreciated his sincerity in expressing that prejudice. Prejudice, which I said, was reasonable because it's like saying, we've found the next president for the Philippines, perfect candidate. And who is this? Well, so-and-so from Basilan or from Tawi-Tawi. Can anything good come out of Basilan or Tawi-Tawi? Not that I'm saying anything really negative about those places, but it's not the capital. It's not even the NCR. It's not even the regional capital. Where would he get all the erudition, all the training, and all the talents to govern the country? And the Messiah was going to be the king of the world. They knew that. So can anything good come out of Nazareth? And Jesus read through that prejudice even before anything was said and appreciated the sincerity of that person who spoke his mind out. And here we go to the first important spiritual conclusion for us, the importance of sincerity, the importance of speaking our mind out, not only in our normal dealings with each other, but more especially when we go to spiritual direction, more especially when we go to confession, more especially when we need advice for our spiritual life. The reason why we go to confession or we even go to spiritual direction is because we know, or we should know, that we can never be really very good directors of ourselves. For ourselves, we come up with rationalizations, justifications of all kinds. So we need an impartial observer to tell us where we're going, what we're doing wrong, what we're doing right. That's why every athlete needs a trainer, needs a coach, if he's going to do anything serious. To go beyond the level of a weekend warrior, as they say, a weekend athlete, to do something serious, like run a marathon or join a triathlon event, you need some trainer. Why? Because by ourselves, it's so easy to skip training for one day or 2 days just because we stayed up late, just because we're putting on weight or whatever other reason. But when there's a trainer, when there's a coach, then we're driven, we're guided, we're motivated. But in order for that to work, there must be sincerity, a sincere relationship. We're not pulling each other's legs, so to speak. What good is it to go to spiritual direction if we're not going to open our hearts? What good is it to go to seek advice from someone who we don't give any or accurate information of? It's like going to the doctor and not telling him all the symptoms, keeping things away from him. So he will come up with the wrong diagnosis. Same thing happens in spiritual direction. But since Nathanael was sincere and expressed that, and our Lord read him even before he could say it to our Lord. He already said it to his friend. Then the following dialogue ensues. Jesus answered and said to him, Philip, before, or rather Nathanael, before Philip called you, I saw you under the fig tree. Nathanael answered him, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. It was a very brief dialogue. But it was all that Nathanael needed, precisely because he was sincere. When a person is sincere, there are no, shall we say, hidden agenda. There is no effort at justification. There is no shall we say, clinging on to the persona that one has made of himself, then the obvious is really obvious. What did our Lord say? Before Philip called you Nathanael, I already saw you sitting under the fig tree. We don't really know what that fig tree is, but Pope Benedict, counting on tradition and the writings of other fathers of the church, tells us that most probably it was an allusion to the fact that the scholars of the law in those times were wont to talk about scripture under a fig tree. So apparently the fig tree is the favored, shall we say, shade. This, again, for those of you who haven't seen figs, this doesn't make much sense. But think of the talisay tree, which we're more familiar with in the Philippines, with wide leaves. Well, the fig tree is like that. It's not a tall tree. It's a very short tree, like the talisay, with big leaves. So it really provides very good shade. And so for those... For that civilization, for those tribes of Israel at that time, it was common for a scribe or for a scholar to just sit under a fig tree, and people gathered, the men folk gathered around him to listen to his discoveries. And so it was an allusion, most probably, to the quote-unquote profession of Nathanael. It must have been a scholar of the law of some sort. And so he was under a fig tree, most probably reading, perhaps even talking with some people. That's where Philip found him, his friend Philip. And our Lord said, before he found you under the fig tree, I saw you. Of course. Nathanael, at those words, concluded what should have been obvious immediately to a clear mind without any prejudices. No. He already concluded he had a prejudice, but he already went over it. Remember, a prejudice is a judgment before all the facts are in. But here came a fact right before him that destroyed that prejudice, so to speak. How can this man know where I was if he is not the Messiah? How could this man know what I was doing if he cannot read through space? How can he even know what I had in mind or my dispositions if, precisely, it's not given to him by God? And so right there and then, he makes an act of faith. Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel. And here Pope Benedict segues into the spiritual sense of great importance to us. Because he said, in that simple affirmation, Nathanael gave us the key where many people fail, philosophers, theologians of our time. Because in fact, he was affirming two characteristics of our Lord Jesus Christ, which cannot be separated from each other. One, Rabbi, you are the Son of God. That our Lord is the Son of God. Well, that's a trite enough remark, right? At this age and time, if you still do not think that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, then there's something wrong with you. Well, unfortunately, that's what the Iglesia ni Cristo teaches. That's what Manalo teaches. They're the only book that the former head of the Iglesia ni Cristo wrote. His sole claim to scholarship. It's a very thin book. It's a pamphlet, really, which was entitled Christ, the Son of God? Because in in the doctrine of Iglesia ni Cristo, Jesus Christ is not the Son of God, but is a creature of God the Father. That's the Arian heresy, condemned already by St. Athanasius and company in the councils of Nicaea, and after that, even in the council of Ephesus, but Nicaea, 325, in the year 325, that doctrine had already been condemned. Because Jesus Christ is not a feature of God the Father. Jesus Christ is God the Son, made man. And God the Son is not a creature. God the Son is co-eternal with Father and Holy Spirit. Anyway, going back to this, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, everybody accepts now. But the second part is important. You are the King. We celebrate that nowadays too. It's a dogma of our faith. It's a big solemnity. Christ the King. But let's pause a little and ask ourselves if we really understand what that means, that Christ is the King of the universe. King? You're not a king of spiritual realities. You're a king of temporal realities. You don't say King of the Angels. Well, you can do that, no? But normally when we say king, we're talking about temporal realities. King of this and that country, king of this and that, later on, perhaps it would even be galaxies or whatever. But to say that our Lord is the King of the universe means that he has dominion over all creation. A dominion that he exercises over space and time. It's not just a dominion at a certain stage or a certain number of years. It's not even a dominion over just a limited space, but of the whole universe, of the whole creation. We have been considering that Jesus Christ, that God, is the King of the universe, or rather, is the Lord of creation, the Lord of history, rather. And we have to believe that. He's the Lord of history, so therefore, he, quote-unquote, manipulates history according to his will, which is always salvific for the good of men. And that lordship extends over the whole universe. Nothing escapes materially that kingship. Well, because if we really believe this, then we should be the most fortunate of creatures. We should be the happiest of creatures. Because we also believe that we're the children of God. And so our Father is the King of the universe. Our Father is the King, the Lord of history. Our Father is manipulating the whole of the material universe for our maximal benefit, optimizing, as it were, all those things. Of course, he has to count on human freedom, ours included. But outside of that, everything else, he manipulates, optimizing the circumstances for our good. He cannot manipulate our will. He does not. He does not manipulate the wills of the 5 billion other people around us. But he works around it. He works with it. Everything else in the universe is under his control, and he's controlling it. That's what divine providence is. My brothers and sisters, let's try really to understand that and live accordingly. And then you will understand why the saints lived the way they did. Or even the saintly people nowadays. See the Pope. You saw Mother Teresa. You see the living saints, as they call them, moving around you. Why they live their lives that way and why they do their projects that way. The audacity, the daring, the radicality of their message and their mission. Nothing, shall we say, slows them down. Nothing holds them back. Because if you know that you're working for the Lord of history, you're working for the King of the whole created universe, then really, what is there to worry about? Because it can happen that your role in it is really that you're going to get clobbered, you know, suffer materially, or even get killed. But if you know that that's part of God's plan, if you know that that's provided for, if you know that that is what is maximally, optimally good for you, then again, you should not worry about that. And so I will die in the process. So what? If that's really the plan of God, because already we have to die anyway. So dying one way or another, the most important thing is to die according to the will of God, to form part of salvation history, to fulfill a role in that history. For as long as that happens, then I'm happy. I should be. But on the other hand, if we're going to live that principle to the full, we also know that while we're alive, then it ain't over yet, as they say. It ain't over until the fat lady sings, as they would say about the opera. If we're still alive, it's because we're still in play. If we're still alive, it means that we still have something to do. So we can never just resign ourselves. Yeah, I'm in God's hands. Let me die now. Some prophets did that, remember? And God told them, no, not yet. I am the king of history, our Lord says. I'm the Lord of history, and you are my son. And you have a role to play. And while you're still alive, you're still in play. And so therefore, don't slow down. Don't lose hope. Don't cross your arms, as I am crossing my arms now. Play that role. Put your mark in your environment. If you're identified with me, then wherever you are, I should be present. And just as our Lord said, when I am lifted up, I shall draw all things to myself. That's what Nathanael did. That's what Bartholomew did. We don't really know very much, but some scholars have seen traces of his work. Can you imagine in India? We always thought that Thomas was the one who went to India, and that's correct. But it seems like Nathanael also did some work in that part. And this is the last point. We don't know what Nathanael did, or Bartholomew. But he's mentioned in the Gospels. He's always in the list of the apostles. Which again, it's not important what people know. It's not important what history says. What's important is to live our lives as God wants now. Bartholomew, Nathanael lived his life as God wanted then. And his name is left recorded for time in the Word of God, in the Gospel. Many great things depend on, forget it, on whether you and I live our lives as God wants. And so again, let's live our lives as God wants. We can make mistakes, but if we're sincere, we fix them. Nathanael started out with a prejudice, but he accepted the new data, immediately embracing it. He didn't cling to his prejudice. He remedied it and rectified it. A foolish consistency is the hobgoblin of little minds, to stick to our guns when we know they're wrongly pointed. That's for fools. That's for the little minded. But for a son of God, we should be ready to open our hearts. As St. John Paul II said, do not be afraid. Open wide the doors of your heart to Jesus Christ. Non abbiate paura. Do not be afraid of what you will discover. Do not be afraid of the challenges that will come, because they're amply provisioned, because Jesus Christ, God, is the Lord of history. I have to end. Let's go to our Blessed Mother as usual, because Jesus Christ may be Christ the King, the Lord of history, but Mary is the Queen. And we just celebrated the queenship of Mary. Let's never forget that too. That in this task of implanting the kingdom of God, in this task of doing what God wants, no matter how little, we have a queen mother was looking at us, smiling, providing, foreseeing everything that we need. The only thing we need to remember is to listen to her voice when she says, do whatever he tells you. You have a few minutes left to concretize your resolutions and end this prayer on your own.